summer month at Glen Abbey. I find that people really get rolling in October. It's a gorgeous day out. It's warm, it's sunny, and you decided to be here this morning. So thank you. It's the best place you could be, and God bless you. And thanks to those watching at home, part of our online church family. Great to see all. Now, we'll begin with the sharing of the peace of Christ. So may the peace of our risen Lord be with you all. Amongst our announcements, big news for many. This Friday at 7:30 p.m. in the gym, pickleball is back. And we thank Betty and Chris Middlebro for organizing these great evenings for us. Now, Yvonne, she's ready to welcome new members into the choir. So if you'd like to sing, please join us Tuesday evenings at 7 p.m. for practices. They're both fun and educational. And also, Yvonne's developing a new program where people can suggest favorite hymns for a hymn sing, either before or after service. And thanks to Sue Lissaman for creating a beautiful box for putting those hymn suggestions into. Well, we are so pleased that Donna is here with us today. And many thanks to Donna McNaught for sponsoring two scholarships for young people who attend school locally. Now, if you know of any musically talented students from grade 11 to fourth year university, they're eligible and they'll be singing with our choir. And if you know someone who might be interested, please contact Yvonne for all the details. We've now purchased the Whole People of God Sunday School curriculum. It's online, it has materials for every age group. And if you give Chris your email, you'll have access to these items so you can easily help or team up with someone to take a Sunday. Thanks to those who have already signed up. And as I say, we can have a total of 36, so there's plenty of room if you think you might be able to help out sometime. So please speak with Chris or contact her via the email that's in my Wednesday letter. Now, to assure that our church is safe for our congregation and for community groups, the property committee applied for and received a grant to install a security system that includes cameras, improved door closures, and other security incidentals, which are going to be undertaken immediately. So on behalf of all of us, thanks to John Cram, Earl Weiss, Steve Houston, and Pat Thompson, for their efforts and hard work in obtaining the grant and securing a contractor for the security system. So thank you, folks. Now, this week, for our celebrations, we'll be celebrating a major event on September 23rd as it's Barb and John Fleming celebrate their 50th golden wedding anniversary. So congratulations, Barb and John. Yeah, absolutely. But if you've played pickleball with Tim Jay, you know he's quite a competitor. So not to be outdone, on September 22nd is Audrey and Tim Jay's 60th wedding anniversary. We're so glad that you're here with us today. And then the next day is Audrey's birthday. So let's all sing happy birthday to Audrey. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Audrey. Happy birthday to you. Congratulations. All right, well, busy week ahead and a busy week for many. So it's important that we do take time out of our lives to do exactly this, that we separate ourselves from all those problems in the world, that we try to forget what we might have coming up or going on, so that we can concentrate on the Christ candle, to listen to the music, and truly prepare our hearts and minds for worship. And a big welcome to our newer folks who are here today. I once heard it said, you're only a visitor once. After that, you're part of the family, and we hope that you find a church home here. We'll begin with the words of the call to worship, and everything you need today, you'll find projected on screen. We give thanks to God for this morning. We give thanks to God for our lives. We give thanks to God for this time of worship. Let us worship God. Now, tomorrow, as we've heard, the state funeral for Queen Elizabeth will be happening. It's on quite early, and it's been an amazing outpouring of love. We've seen now lines up to 24 hours for people to pass by her casket. People waited overnight in 6 degrees Celsius weather. And I'd like to thank Prem for a suggestion that we sing The Lord's My Shepherd today, which is one of Queen Elizabeth's favorite hymns. It was sung at her wedding, at her jubilee, and I'm sure we'll be hearing it tomorrow. So the words will be on screen. It's number 747 in your hymn books, and I invite you to please rise as we all sing together. Please be seated. And we'll continue with the prayer of confession and invocation that you'll find projected here. Let us all say together, gracious God, you put us on the right path when we have gone astray. In the rush of daily living, we have lost the ability to be still. Please help us to seek moments of peace amidst the busiest days. In our haste to judge others harshly, we have lost the ability to see the good in each compassion. Help us to look compassionately and discover skills and values of lasting worth. In our concern to be successful in this world, we have lost the way of faith which leads to your realm. Please help us to return to Christian discipleship and sharing with others in Christ's life-bringing work. Please find us through your Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. And the really good news of the gospel is that even though we get so caught up in the busyness of all our lives, if we can take a little time out, God is right there to be with us, to give us some solitude, to provide the compassion we need to help us through life. If we can just take a few moments out to still our minds and to speak with God. And God forgives you if you read ahead in the prayer and you say a word in the next line when you're not supposed to. So thank God for that. And that is truly good news indeed. When Chris and I were in Nashville, there was on the regular country station, not on a Christian station, but there was this beautiful song that I heard there, Zach Williams and Dolly Parton. And I heard it, and I thought, oh, I've got to bring it back for you. It's entitled, There Was Jesus. So I invite us all to rise as you are able. It's the first time hearing it, so you might just want to let the words and song wash over you. And if you feel like singing along, please feel free to do so. So please rise as you are able. I thought the words might apply to a lot of people.
Every time I try to make it on my own, every time I try to stand, start to fall, and all those lonely roads that I traveled on, there was Jesus. When the life I built came crashing to the ground, when the friends I had were nowhere to be found, I couldn't see it then, but I can see it now. Well, there was Jesus. In the way, and in the searching, in the healing, like a blessing buried in the broken pieces. Every minute, every moment, where I've been or where I'm going, even when I didn't know it or couldn't see it, there was Jesus. So this man who needs a major kind of forgiveness at a price I couldn't pay. I'm not perfect, so I thank God every day. Well, there was Jesus.
There was Jesus.
In the way, in the searching, in the healing, in the hurting, like a blessing buried in broken pieces. Shadows of the alleys,
there was Jesus.
In the fire, in the furnace,
there was Jesus.
Always is and always was. No, I never walked alone.
Searching in the healing and the hurting,
Please be seated. I think we've all been through some times like that. It's a pretty strong message for us. Now, I think I'm going to leave Buford till next week because the sermon's kind of long. Joan, you have the option if you want to stay in or if you want to go out to Sunday school. Totally up to you. Going to stay here? All right then. So thank you to the teachers for today. Next week. All right. Let's bow our heads in prayer, please. Loving God, oh, wow, we give you so much thanks for this world you've created, for these beautiful days, for the love of the folks that surround us, of our church family, of our families. We're just so grateful. And in each of our lives, we do go through struggles. We go through times where we really need your help. And everyone here today needs to hear your word. It's probably different for every one of us. So it might come in the songs that we sing. It might be in the scriptures we're about to hear. But no matter what, please open up our minds and hearts to take in your word and then let us do something in response. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And I would like to call over Rose Bell Castro for our readings today from 1 Timothy and Psalm 79. Thank you, Rose.
Good morning.
Morning.
Our first reading this morning is from Timothy, chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. First of all, then I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all who are in high positions, so that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and dignity. This is right and is acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires everyone to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God. There is also one mediator between God and humankind, Christ Jesus, himself human, who gave himself a ransom for all. This was attested at the right time. For this was, I was appointed and a herald and an apostle. I'm telling the truth. I am not lying. A teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. A responsive psalm is from Psalm 79 that can be found in Voices United 793. O God, the nations have entered your domain, defiled your holy temple, and laid Jerusalem in ruins. They have left your servants' bodies for scavenging birds, the flesh of your faithful ones for wild beasts. Their blood was shed like water around Jerusalem, with none to bury them. We have become the taunt of our neighbors, mocked and scorned by those around us. How long, O God, will you be angry forever? Will your jealous wrath burn like fire? Pour out your rage on the nations that do not acknowledge you, on the realms that will not call on your name. For have devoured Jacob and desolated Israel's home. Do not hold the sins of past generations against us. Let your compassion come swiftly to meet us, for we are sunk very low. Help us, O God, our Savior, for the glory of your name. Deliver us and forgive our sin for the honor of your name. Thanks be to God for the reading of His holy words.
Thank you, Rose, for a fine job on the readings. That was a happy little psalm. Apparently, things weren't going too well in Israel at the time, but God's compassion comes no matter where we're at in life. Our anthem today is entitled, My Savior.
As a shepherd tends his sheep in a quiet meadow, so my Savior watches me and cares for me each day. As a captain sails the sea through the storms and shadows, so my Savior stayed with me and keeps me unafraid. When I call, He understands. My Savior is my friend. As a parent calms the fear where there's pain and sorrow, so my Savior comforts me and helps me to find my way.
Thank you very much, choir, and thank you, Yvonne, and especially to you, Florian. Yeah. So you can be a part of this choir. All you have to do is come out Tuesday night, go through the entrance exams and the grilling and okay, it's easier than that. All right, our Old Testament reading today comes from the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 8, verse 18 to chapter 9, verse 1. This is a tremendous reading of dismay but compassion. And so we listen for God's word as we hear what Jeremiah wrote. My joy is gone. Grief is upon me. My heart is sick. Hark, the cry of my poor people from far and wide in the land. Is the Lord not in Zion? Is her king not in her? Why have they provoked me to anger with their images, with their foreign idols? The harvest is past. The summer is ended. And we are not saved. For the hurt of my people, I am hurt. I mourn, and dismay has taken hold of me. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then has the health of my poor people not been restored? Oh, that my head were a spring of water and my eyes a fountain of tears, so that I might weep day and night for the suffering of my people. Thanks be to God for these holy words. So I was a little apprehensive this morning. I got thinking about it. I thought, you know, last week I was telling you how next week's going to be the really good part. And, and then I was thinking, oh my gosh, have I overhyped it? Can I deliver? It's kind of like when the Buffalo Bills were getting so hyped up and playing the Super Bowl champions. But I didn't mention that last week. My message today is titled Sabbatical Reflections Part 2. As there was simply too much to cover in one sermon. And I'm sorry, today's installment is going to be a bit longer, but I thought that having part 3 next week might be kind of pushing it a bit. So you might recall last week, we discussed how this time away was very valuable, even if it didn't go exactly as planned. I had spent considerable time taking care of families who needed it, then reconnected with old neighbors, friends, relatives, ministry colleagues, the church that I grew up in, as well as the second best boss I ever had, with some surprising outcomes. And that basically, not by intention, but that took us to the end of July. In August, on the first Friday, I officiated at a wedding for our veterinarian who we love. It had been rescheduled several years. This was the third attempt. And it was well worth the wait. And then the next morning, the sabbatical really began. I headed south all alone. I drove to Middletown, Ohio. And after checking into my hotel, I thought I should pick up dinner until we had a thunderstorm of biblical proportions. It was like a car wash. Well, I finally decided to dash out and make my way to a Steak and Shake that I could see in the distance. That'd be worth getting a little wet for, until I got there and found that they were closed for no apparent reason. But there was a reason I was put there. Disappointed, I swung my vehicle around, and as the rain had slowed down, I got to see this. It was glorious, and I managed to take this picture between swipes of the windshield wipers. I think it was a heavenly reminder of not just the beauty of creation, but that after storms in life, there eventually will be sunshine again. Now, the reason I was staying in Middletown on the Saturday night was to attend church in the morning. If you've driven I-75 between Dayton and Cincinnati, you may have noticed Solid Rock Church with this huge statue of Jesus being really hard to miss. Now, since the year 2000, I think I've driven by it 85 times. And each time I thought, I should go to that church sometime. Now, in what must have been an event that would have been so difficult to explain to the congregation. Lightning struck that statue of Jesus, and it burned completely. While showing complete faith in the future, the congregation rallied, and they had this new statue of Jesus built. It's even taller than the previous one, and more welcoming, I think. So it's a really big church campus. So does that mean they're more welcoming? Well, no. And yes. I think I better explain that one. When I arrived on Sunday morning, there were several entrances to the sanctuary and the main office building, and they were labeled A, B, C, D, E, and so on, but there were no directions. I watched for where most people were going, used that entrance, and there were no greeters. There weren't even signs on how to get to the sanctuary. Now, in the Brooklyn Tabernacle, they have greeters about every 100 feet. Well, I finally found my way into the sanctuary, and unlike a lot of our churches, people actually want to sit in the front. In fact, there were shawls or prayer scarves laid out on seats to reserve them. Well, having arrived quite early, I finally found a seat about 5 or 6 rows from the front on the aisle. And let me tell you, they have a lot of respect for their ministers there. In fact, right across the sanctuary, there are signs saying, "Front row reserved for our pastors and their families." Well, I sat there alone for about 20 minutes. And there were a lot of people attending with a wide diversity of age and races, and they seemed very friendly to each other. People would go by chatting to their friends in each aisle, but not one person said hello to me. I took note of that for our purposes. Well, then everything changed. A man in his late 30s carrying a Bible was saying hello to almost everyone, and he came over and greeted me. I told him I was glad he did, as no one had talked to me for 20 minutes. Well, he was one of their pastors and seemed concerned, and he asked where I was from. So I explained I was a minister from Canada who had passed by this church about 80 times and had stayed in Middletown last night just so I could attend that day. Well, he asked if I had met their lead pastor and then went and brought her over to meet me. And as it was almost time for the service to start, and this was nice, he asked if I was alone. And I said, yes. And he said, well, then why don't you come and sit with me in the front row? And that way you'll be sitting with someone you know. Nice. Quite a turnaround. So then he asked what denomination I was with. And I told him it was a combination of Methodist, Presbyterian, and Congregationalist, united and only found in Canada. And he said that their church came from the Pentecostal tradition. And I could expect people to be quite vocal. He was right. Some might be dancing, even some jumping up and down would not be uncommon. You see that next slide? This is their sanctuary after most people had left. I took it on the way out. They had these huge LED screens, which provided a visual extravaganza as a backdrop, and their band really got the place awake, involved, and emotional. Then, when the lead pastor was welcoming people, she told them my story, and there was much applause and people slapping me on the back and welcome. So were they welcoming? No. And then, yes. Well, something else I noticed. Later on, I was watching a recording of that service. And although online services are of great value for those who are away or not well or unable to attend for whatever reason, there is no comparison to being at a live service. So I would encourage anyone watching today who lives within driving distance of Glen Abbey and is well enough to attend, please come to our live service on Sundays at 10. We're almost completely back to normal now, and it's a whole different experience when shared with your church family. So this was an exciting, fulfilling worship experience, and I left filled with the Holy Spirit and feeling really good. So from there, I drove to the Smoky Mountains in Sevierville, Tennessee. I got my groceries, and my self-imposed exile had begun. Now, I know some will be thinking, what's the big deal? I'm by myself all the time. But for this retreat, I had no contact with any human or pets. No leaving the property, no phone calls, no texts, no television, no radio, no internet, no music, no reading for pleasure, nothing except reading my spiritual book, reflecting, praying, reading the section over again, making some notes, and then spending the evening reading Bible commentaries in complete silence for almost 6 very long days. And my goodness, does time ever pass slowly. On Tuesday morning, I woke up and I thought, is it Thursday? No, it's Tuesday. In the evenings, when I thought 2 hours had passed, it'd be about 20 minutes. And that same Tuesday, I started talking to myself. I said out loud, okay, what are we going to have for breakfast? And then I told myself, stop that right now. This is not The Shining by Stephen King. Well, this truly was the ideal location to spend these days. I hadn't been to this particular cabin in a long time. It had been dark when I arrived the night before, so the first morning when I opened the door to the balcony, it was what I imagined stepping into the Garden of Eden would be like. Incredible trees, flowering plants, and other foliage had grown 30 to 100 feet high to provide a complete privacy barrier. Can we have the next slide, please? I spent many hours in those rocking chairs, having those how great thou art moments that I described last week. It occurred to me it was like staying in a luxurious treehouse, the perfect location to reconnect with God. Now at night, with no light pollution, the stars, they were amazing. And one night, there was even a supermoon, which I took with my camera. Well, during the many hours there, it truly was life-changing. I really became one with creation, seeing butterflies, hummingbirds, and salamanders coming so close to me, smelling the sweet mountain air fragrant with wildflowers, hearing the various songbirds, and one evening the thunder that literally rolled for miles. Feeling the warmth of the sun and noticing how different the valley looked, depending on whether or not the sun was shining on it. Being attuned like never before to the nature surrounding us and realizing what a very small part of God's creation I am. And with being so alone, with no distractions, with complete silence, your mind opens up like never before. And you think about things you've long forgotten, things you've done, things you should have done differently, things you should have done, things you didn't get to do. Well, to be honest, earlier this year, I was feeling pretty tired and somewhat discouraged and a little underappreciated. During my isolation time, I was able to ponder why this is, and yet people I've just met at weddings or funerals rave about the job I do. And it occurred to me that maybe it's like in some marriages, where at first everything is so unexpected and appreciated. And then after 5.5 years together, certain standard of excellence is expected and taken for granted. It might also explain why the average time a minister spends with the church these days is now under 3 years. The book that I chose, no, I believe God led me to, is called The Way of the Heart by Henri Nouwen. It's connecting with God through isolation, silence, and prayer. Exactly what I wanted to do. I don't recommend this book to you because my jaw dropped when I started reading and found out it is written very, very specifically for ministers. That fact had been nowhere in the description, and it was beyond perfect. It was a great gift from God. I was so moved by how Ari Nouwen goes deep into the minds and hearts of clergy and hits the nail on the head so many times about the unique nature of this vocation and the ways we are challenged. How what are supposed to be spiritual lives we're called to become so busy with meetings and projects and finances and trying to please everyone and congregation building, and they become somewhat secular, and we're subject to the compulsions of the secular world while not having enough time to connect to God. Well, in a nutshell, his cure for this is isolation. He calls solitude the holy place where ministry and spirituality embrace each other. It is the place of conversion where the old self dies and the new self is born. The place where the emergence of the new man occurs. And that's a pretty good way of describing what I experienced that week. More about that later. When I reached the end of my exile, I couldn't wait to drive to the Nashville airport and greet my lovely wife. I missed her so much. So I stood at the bottom of the escalator with a large handmade sign in one hand and a dozen roses in the other. And I got a lot of, ah, and nice looks from women of all ages, and even a few guys. Actually, I could hear one woman go by me saying, I wish somebody would meet me with flowers and a sign. Well, we had a wonderful time in Nashville and back in the Smoky Mountains. And our way north, we stopped in Williamsville, Kentucky to see the Ark Encounter. They actually followed the directions laid out in the book of Genesis to build a life-size ark, and it is huge, really huge. Ponder this, it's 510 feet long, 85 feet wide, and 51 feet high. Think about the size of your properties. 510 feet long, 85 wide, 51 high, and it makes it the largest timber structure in the world. As the Bible instructs, it is on three floors. Well, it took about 2.5 hours to tour all three floors inside, and although they admit to having to use artistic license at times, an incredible amount of research and thought went into the design and execution that is so detailed as to what it could have been like. So then we continued on to the Finger Lakes region. Have you ever been to Seneca Falls, New York? Or maybe a better question is, do you like the movie It's a Wonderful Life? Seneca Falls is the town that many feel Capra's Bedford Falls was based on. This bridge might look familiar to you, where George met Clarence. And it actually exists, along with the It's a Wonderful Life Museum, which is small in size, but full of fascinating memorabilia. And even this day contributed to my learning. It's a tangible reminder of how much our own lives contribute to the lives of others, and that although we may have down times, it truly is a wonderful life. So what else did I learn? I learned that the first couple of weeks might have gone the way they did so that God could make me fully realize it's more important to be there for people and to take good care of them than read 17 volumes of Bible commentaries. I learned that although most folks would have a little more contact with people or TV to pass the time than I did, being alone makes time pass very slowly. I read an article that said loneliness is epidemic in our culture. And now, as part of my renewal, I will be focused on helping to end it. I learned that making people feel really welcome and comfortable in church can be achieved by not just having greeters, but by speaking to the people around you, inviting them to sit with you, and inviting them to stay for coffee afterwards, which I hope will be starting up quite soon. In this book, and I'm going to talk more about it some future Sunday, but Nouwen talks a lot about prayers of our heart, that prayer has become so intellectualized that sometimes it doesn't really come from the heart. So he talks about having very short prayers. And my prayer of the heart is to ask God to make me a better man and a better minister and bless those in need of blessing. And something that is possibly my greatest takeaway is the transformation I received to become even more compassionate. I was so tempted to read so much of this, but I didn't want to go till 6 o'clock. So, I'm just going to read a couple of paragraphs from this book. He's talking about the desert father, Anthony, and he said, Anthony had learned to diagnose the hearts of people and the mood of his time, and to offer insight, comfort, and consolation. Solitude had made him a compassionate man. Here we reach the point where ministry and spirituality touch each other. It is compassion. Compassion is the fruit of solitude and the basis of all ministry. The purification and transformation that takes place in solitude manifest themselves in compassion. And then he has an interesting point. He says, let us not underestimate how hard it is to be compassionate. Compassion is hard because it requires the inner disposition to go with others to the place where they are weak, vulnerable, lonely, and broken. But this is not our spontaneous response to suffering. What we desire most is to do away with suffering by fleeing from it or finding a quick cure for it. As busy, active, relevant ministers, we want to earn our bread by making a real contribution. This means first and foremost doing something to show that our presence makes a difference. And so we ignore our greatest gift, which is our ability to enter into solidarity with those who suffer. Well, even prior to my isolation, I like to think of myself as compassionate. It would have been easy to say, I'm on sabbatical, just contact Glenn McPherson. But by providing pastoral care and presiding at Tanya's funeral, at Carl's funeral, visiting Candace and Paul in the hospice, this is ministry that really matters. Now, I'm not very big on self-promotion, but one of the most affirming things I've ever been told, Yvonne was actually a witness to. I don't know if you remember this, but the short version is after Tanya's funeral, she and I were chatting by the piano, and a man came back in, and he said, can I shake your hand? I'm a friend of Tanya's, and I was devastated, but I'm leaving here a better man because of you and your words. They were phenomenal and gave me goosebumps. Thank you so much. That's about right, isn't it? Well, I am newly dedicated to going with you to those dark places. The words from Jeremiah 8 today, the Lord works in mysterious ways. It spoke so well to it. Oh, that my head were a spring of water and my eyes a fountain of tears, so that I might weep day and night for the suffering of my people. If you are suffering, call me and I'll go with you. Wow, having returned, it feels like a fresh start and a breath of fresh air. After 2.5 years of trying to minister during a pandemic that no one could be prepared for, in addition to 2 surgeries, it was honestly really hard to keep up the energy and positivity. Many ministers burned out and retired early, which contributed to the large number of churches that can't get ministers these days. But absence truly does make the heart grow fonder. I feel like my enthusiasm and energy have been restored. And someone who watches the services online said that last Sunday I looked the happiest she had seen me in a long time. Now, I did many more things and had more valuable experience than I've had time to recount here. Did I get to do everything I had planned? No. But I'm determined not to beat myself up over it, because there's always next year, and this was only the first half taken this summer. With the resulting greater enthusiasm, greater compassion, greater connection to God, greater appreciation for all of you, and hopefully you for me, was it a good investment and use of time? I truly believe it was. And for that, I say thanks to the board, thanks to all of you, and thanks be to God. Amen. There will be no continuation next week. It was tempting. I had so much more to put in. I had to cut it down a lot last night. Anyways, this is our normal offering time. And if you have a physical offering with you, there are plates in the narthex for folks at home or those who prefer internet banking. It's very easy to make an e-transfer to donations at glenabbeyunitedchurch.com. But whether it's gifts of finances, gifts of your time, gifts of your talent, just being here, you're all so appreciated. So thank you very, very much. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Gracious God, what a day to be here. What a day to worship you. What a privilege it is to take time out and speak to you in prayer. And we are thankful. We're thankful for this church. We're thankful for this church family. We're thankful for our own families and for the wonderful lives you have blessed us with. So much of it we take for granted. The wonderful homes that we have, transportation, sanitation, health services, so many different things, all the food we could ever want provided whenever we want it. And we think of other places in the world who don't have the clean water and everything that we have think is normal. And we think about places where shots ring out and bombs are heard, and we ask for your loving touch to reach these folks and their leaders so that peace can reign, so that justice can be fulfilled, that they can have enough. We think as well in our own country of indigenous folks, and we thank them for walking on this land and that we share it today. And we ask you, truth and reconciliation may finally be available and come to reality between us. God, we know that there are people who are so in need, and whether it's mental, physical, spiritual, emotional help, we ask you to wrap your loving arms around them. And in each of our lives, we have things going on. Some of them are great, some of them are terrible, but we know that even though they may be too personal to share with our closest friends, that you are always ready to listen. So in the silence of these moments, Lord, please hear our silent prayers. When the time is right, no matter how you choose to speak to us, Lord, we so look forward to your answer. And we thank you that our church family friends are starting to come back, and we look forward to future weeks of getting together and getting reunited and being here to worship you. And most of all, we thank you that you would want to come into this world as Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord, who taught us to pray together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, again, tomorrow during the funeral, a piece of music that you're likely to hear is Jerusalem. And we're going to be singing this next hymn that is to the tune of Jerusalem, but the words that we'll be singing are so rich and so meaningful. It's number 258, and I invite you, maybe afterwards, you might want to reread the words. They are something. So I invite you to please rise as you are able. The words will be on screen, and it's number 258 in your hymn books.
A world of God, so vast and strange, profound and wonderful and fair. Beyond the utmost reach of thought, but not beyond our Maker's care. We are not strangers on this earth, whirling amid the suns of space. We are God's children, this our home, with those of every clime and race. O world where human life is lived, so strangely mingling joy and pain, so full of evil and of good, so needful that the good shall reign. It is this world that God has loved, and goodness was its Maker's plan. The promise of God's triumph is a humble birth in Bethlehem. O world of times, thy stretching years, there was a day when time stood still. A central moment when there rose a cross upon a cruel hill. In pain and death, love's power was seen. The mystery of time revealed, the wisdom of the ways of God, the grace through which our hurt